Okay, back up here, the big picture we're looking at. So in Genesis, by the end of Genesis chapter 11, this fundamental question of sin and its corrupting effect on God's very good creation, that question remains unresolved. This creation is not the way it's supposed to be, and clearly some kind of extraordinary work was going to be required, was going to be necessary to heal the sin-sick world, to restore the broken creation that it might be all that God intends it to be. And we see that work begin to take shape in Genesis chapter 12 with the call of Abram, who of course is later known as Abraham. And God calls Abraham, and he promises to bless this man, to give him a great multitude of descendants living securely in this blessed and bountiful homeland, and he promises to bless all the nations of the world through him. And this very important veiled statement, that's in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, that a man, a descendant of Eve, would win the ultimate victory over Satan, that promise is narrowed in the election of Abraham to his lineage. And then we see later we see the family line of the Messiah being further specified to the lineage of Abraham's son Isaac, and Isaac's son Jacob, and Jacob's son Judah. So we see this specification of this lineage. And Jacob, also named Israel, we looked at some last week, he had 12 sons who are, of course, they're the family heads of what are known, not surprisingly, as the 12 tribes of Israel. They're the sons of Jacob. Jacob is Israel, the sons of Israel. And so they're the family heads of the 12 tribes of Israel. And the 11th of those brothers, we looked at last week, Joseph, he was the firstborn son of Jacob's beloved wife, Rachel. He was sold into slavery by his brothers, and as we saw last week, by God's blessing and God's providence, he rose to a position of prominence in Egypt. You recall that God revealed through Joseph's interpretation of Pharaoh's two dreams that there were going to be 7 years of abundance, followed by 7 years of extreme famine. And then Joseph was put in charge of Pharaoh's grain conservation and storage program so that when the famine hit, Egypt was the only place where you go to get food. And so that was because of God's providence and his revelation through the interpretation of those dreams. So people from all over the region are coming to Joseph to buy food. And this led ultimately to Jacob, the father of the 12 sons, and his 12 sons and their sons, 70 men in all, and all their wives living together in Egypt under the blessing of Joseph's rule. Well, Jacob died, the father, he died in Egypt at the age of 147. His body was embalmed, which was an Egyptian practice. It was embalmed and then taken to Canaan for interment at the cave of Machpelah. And I said all that last week. Genesis 50, 24 and 25, it says, "And Joseph said to his brothers, I'm about to die, but God will visit you and bring you up out of this land to the land that he swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. Then Joseph made the sons of Israel swear, saying, God will surely visit you, and you shall carry up my bones from here." Then it says in Hebrews 11, 22, "By faith Joseph, Joseph, when at the end of his end of life, made mention of the exodus of the sons of Israel and gave instruction regarding his bones." So here at the end of his life, Joseph expresses his continuing faith in God. And though he and the entire family of Israel, they'd lived in Egypt for many decades. You know, they'd been there for many decades. He trusted that God would be true to his promise. And one day he would bring them into Canaan's land. He would bring them into the promised land, the land that he had sworn to give Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So he's been there for decades, but he knows God has said this, and he's going to do this one day. And when that happens, I want you to take me out of here. So he's faithful there. Joseph died in Egypt at the age of 110. That's about 54 years after Jacob died. And he was also embalmed, and he was put in a coffin in Egypt. Now, there's some uncertainty about the dating of these events. You know, and you can see arguments back and forth about them. But according to the dating that seems most reasonable to me and most reasonable to many other people, Joseph died around 1805 B.C. Okay, 1,805 years B.C. And Joseph's brothers and the remainder of his generation passed away. So you're some years after that. You see that in Exodus chapter 1, verse 6. But the people of Israel, they're multiplying rapidly. You know, they're multiplying rapidly. You say, well, this is a blessing of God. But they're multiplying rapidly, and I assume this had been going on throughout their time in Egypt and simply was continuing at an accelerated pace. So as the population gets larger, it's so they're multiplying rapidly. And then we read in Exodus chapter 1, verse 8, this very famous passage or statement, that a new king came to power in Egypt, one who did not know Joseph. And remember Joseph and all that he'd done and the position that he held. But when it says he didn't know Joseph, that need not mean, and I think almost certainly doesn't mean, that he wasn't aware of who Joseph was. It more likely means that he didn't accept any obligation toward Joseph's people. He didn't know him in the sense that he didn't recognize the worth of Joseph's contribution to Egypt, and he refused to honor any prior arrangement that existed for protecting the Hebrews. Basically, he turns his back on him. He doesn't know him in that he gives him nothing, no credit. And so he doesn't know him in that sense. But we don't know who this ruler was. You see, we don't know who this ruler was. Some think he was a foreign ruler of Egypt, one of the group of rulers known as the Hyksos that ruled in northern Egypt from about 1720 B.C., until they were expelled in 1570 B.C. by the native pharaoh Amos, or Amosis. So that would have been about 150 years. You had these foreign rulers ruling, the Hyksos in northern Egypt, 1720 or 30 down to about 1570. Some think it was one of those rulers. Now others think it was Amos. It was the one who expelled the Hyksos in 1570 B.C. Others think that it was a pharaoh prior to the Hyksos. So sometime between Joseph's death in 1805 and the arrival and the reign of the Hyksos in northern Egypt, 1730, 1720 B.C. It was one of the pharaohs between that time. And then the Hyksos rulers and those who ruled after Amos expelled the Hyksos, they simply continued the oppression that had been begun. Because once you have a group of people working as slaves, well, then you're in business. So, but we don't know. But what we do know is that there's a shift in policy toward the Hebrews with the coming of the new king. You know, that's no question about that. Who this king is unclear. But it's clear that there's a shift in policy with the coming of this new king. And that shift was tied to concern over the size of the Hebrew population and suspicion that they might align with the ruling group's enemies in the event of a war. That's what they're upset about. You have this large population, and you're thinking, they're not natives, and I don't know which way they're going to go. So there was concern about that. So they made the Hebrews slaves in the hope that making life miserable for them, that would restrain their population growth. That was the idea. If I make these guys' lives just so miserable and they're so bummed, that will eventually slow down the population growth that's going on. But the more the Hebrews were oppressed, the more they multiplied. You see, which that then in turn fueled even greater dread of them. because we're trying to restrain their growth by making their lives miserable, and they're continuing to multiply. And so now there's even greater dread, and so the Egyptians, in turn, they ramped up the oppression. They're sticking with the strategy, says, okay, we just aren't doing it hard enough. And so you see in Exodus chapter 1, 13 and 14, it says, so they ruthlessly made the people of Israel work as slaves and made their lives bitter with hard service in mortar and brick and in all kinds of work in the field. In all their work, they ruthlessly made them work as slaves. And so what you can see here, you see an emphasis. You see this emphasis here on the difficulty, how difficult their lives were. And they seem to forget that later, right? But they really, their lives were difficult, and that's being emphasized here. And at some point, during this era of oppression of the Hebrews, at some point during this time, the king of Egypt, he commands the Hebrew midwives. Now, this is one of the things when I was talking about teaching Moses. If you've been around the church, you know, you've heard the story of Moses a lot in your life. But here you have this Hebrew, this king, the then king, sometime during this era of oppression, the then king of the Hebrews, he commands these midwives, Shiphrah and Puah, now who, by the way, they're almost certainly senior midwives, see, who functioned as administrators over other midwives. They're not the only two midwives, because the population is huge at this point. But they're the ones who administer it, so the commands to them are, what you're going to have to do, we want you to kill all the boy babies. So the agency you're in charge of, the midwives agency, I want you to make sure that they kill all the male children that are born to the Hebrews. Exodus chapter 1, verse 17 says, but the midwives feared God and did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, but let the male children live. I'm having another strange experience here with, this is no doubt operator error on my part, but I'm looking at this, I'm seeing our children in. But let the male children live. So they're under this command, but they wouldn't do it. And then verse 20 of chapter 1, it says, and the people multiplied and grew very strong. You see, God is multiplying the descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That's what he's doing. He's doing that as he had promised, and every attempt to thwart that blessing is turned back. You see, it's like, I'm going to do this. No, God is blessing them, and it doesn't matter what you do. I've got this strategy, what we're going to do. We're going to make their lives miserable, and we're going to double it and really make it miserable. Grow, grow, grow. We're going to kill the male children. Grow, grow, grow. Why? Because God has set his mind to bless them. And that's how it works. Exodus chapter 1, verse 22, Pharaoh decides to put the responsibility for killing the Israelite babies on his own people. He says, apparently this isn't working out. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to tell all my people, what you're to do is you throw the Hebrew babies, the male babies, when you see a newborn, you see an infant, one of the Hebrews, you drown him in the Nile River. That's your job. I've now put that responsibility on you. Now, this is a long-term plan for population control. That's what he's about. Now, during this time, you have two Levites, Amram and his wife Jochebed. They had a son. And when Jochebed saw that the son was beautiful or good or fine, you see, there's how do you translate that word? Well, she hid him so that he wouldn't be killed. And that child is, of course, Moses. Now, accepting that the Exodus occurred in 1446 BC, which I think is the right date, for accepting that, and that Moses was 80 years old at the time, that means that he would have been born in 1526 BC. Now, his brother Aaron is 3 years older. You can see that in Exodus chapter 7, verse 7. Apparently, he'd been born before this edict. He was born before that edict that the people were to kill the Hebrew children, since there's no mention of him being exposed to a similar peril. So it looks like he's born, then we get this edict that comes down, and then we have this account of Moses. And some 1,600 years later, the writer of the letter of Hebrews, he says, by faith Moses, when he was born, was hidden for 3 months by his parents because they saw that the child was beautiful and were not afraid of the king's edict. You see, it was by faith in God's purpose for their child, which purpose they perceived from something about the child's appearance that was taken as a sign of God's favor. In some way, shape, or form, there was something about the child's appearance that they saw and perceived as a sign of God's favor. So it was by faith in God's purpose for their child, you see, that Moses' parents hid him despite the risk of doing so. You know, that it's no small thing to defy the king of Egypt. I've said this in other contexts, but an ancient ruler, yeah, have you killed, not even sneeze. I mean, to have you killed would be nothing. And nobody would think a thing about it. It wouldn't be like, hey, you know, I've got due process coming to me. No due process. The king's the king, and if he kills you, he kills you. And so it was no small thing to do that, you see. His parents, Moses' parents, were motivated by faith in light of some kind of spiritual insight into his significance. You see, this child was going to be used by God for something special, and they had faith in that. And it says they hid the child. Then after 3 months, you know the story. After 3 months, he could no longer be hidden. Whether that's his cries are more powerful now, he's not as responsive to rocking and keeping quiet. But after 3 months, when he could no longer be hidden, Jochebed, she waterproofs this papyrus basket. She puts the little baby in there and placed it among the reeds. So, see, it wouldn't float. She puts it among the reeds near the riverbank where she knew that Pharaoh's daughter came to bathe. Or at least suspected that, because that's what happened. So she puts it right out there among these reeds, and Pharaoh's daughter comes and she spots it and says, bring me that basket. She spots it, she opens the basket, and it says here that she realized that this was one of the Hebrew babies that her father had ordered the people to drown. She knew that. But when she opens and sees this crying baby, it says she took pity on him. She took pity on this crying baby. And can you just see this picture? And this is part of the thing about how God works. God is working. He's going to deliver his people. And here's this little baby sitting in this basket in a river. Just defenseless as can be. God says, here's how we'll do it. I'm going to put this little baby here. He's going to deliver Israel. No way. He's going to die. No chance. Okay, so she sees the child, takes pity on him. And then, of course, the baby's sister Miriam comes over. She says, hey, would you like me to find a Hebrew woman to nurse the baby? Now, sometimes we think about this. Well, you know, the Pharaoh's daughter is really dense. I don't think the Pharaoh's daughter cared. And she may have suspected. Look, I'm not stupid. I know what's going on. But she already knows this is a Hebrew child, and she's taking the child. So I don't think she would care. But she says, no, yeah, that's a good idea. You go ahead and you do that. And so, of course, then Pharaoh's daughter ends up giving Moses, giving the boy, the child, to his mother to be weaned. And that would take 3 or 4 years at that time. That was how that worked. So here, you raise your baby for 3 or 4 years, and then he'll be mine. And by the way, I'll pay you for it. I just say, it's just beautiful, isn't it? This is God at work. And by the way, I'll pay you for it. And that's what happened. I just love the way God works. Now, Pharaoh's daughter named the child Moses. It says because she drew him out of the water. Now, Mose was a fairly common Egyptian name. Thutmose, Amos. You see that a lot. It was a fairly common Egyptian name, meaning son or to beget a son. But the princess apparently chose that name or some variation of it because it sounded like the Hebrew word for drawing out. So Douglas Stewart says in his commentary on Exodus, he says, she both consciously honors the Hebrew origins of her son and also makes him legitimately Egyptian with a name in her own language that emphasizes that she is adopting a son. Well, I think that's kind of neat. You see, she has, it's an Egyptian name or a variation of it, but it also responds to the Hebrew name, I drew him out of the water. So she honors his origin, but doesn't stand out so much in an Egyptian context. Stephen says in Acts chapter 7, verse 21 and 22, Pharaoh's daughter brought Moses up as her own son. So he's being raised in the big time. He was instructed, he says, in all the wisdom of the Egyptians. So he's raised as in Pharaoh's household. He's raised and gets all the benefit of that. Now, when Moses is 40 years old, it says in Acts 7:23, Moses is 40 years old. He's taking note of his people's burdens. He's just seeing, you know, it's just striking him. He's out looking and just seeing, you know, the Hebrews are really getting pounded. This is real. So he's taking note of that. When he sees an Egyptian who's abusing a Hebrew, he's wrongly beating this Hebrew. And in defense of the Hebrew, Moses kills the Egyptian. He kills this Egyptian and he buries the body, and he's trying to do this on the down low. You know, he kills him, buries the body, he's hoping that this will just kind of die down. And the next day he tries to break up a fight between these two Hebrews. Two different Hebrews fighting, and he says, brothers, you know, why are you doing that? And the one who's in the wrong says, hey, who made you prince and judge over us? Are you going to kill me like you killed the Egyptian? Ooh. See, when he said that, then Moses knew at that point, see, that his deed had become too well known to remain hidden. And he knew it would only be a matter of time before the Egyptians were after him. The Egyptian authorities would be, and sure enough, Pharaoh heard of it. And Pharaoh sought to kill him. And Moses then fled to Midian. And over here, and you can extend that out, but that region, what we call the Gulf of Aqaba, east and south of that. Moses goes and he flees to Midian because he's under siege from Pharaoh, who wants to kill him for this. Hebrews 11, 24 to 26 says, by faith Moses, when he was grown up, refused to be called a son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing instead to be mistreated with the people of God than to have the temporary pleasure of sin, considering the reproach of the Christ greater wealth than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking to the reward. You see, this is what he, by faith, Moses chose to identify with the people of God and thus to share in their mistreatment. That's why he's on the run. That's why Pharaoh's trying to kill him. Why? Because he identified with the Hebrews and he saw this man abusing this Hebrew and said, that's not going to happen. And so he chose to identify with God's people. And because of that, he's suffering this mistreatment. So it's by faith that he does that. That he identifies with them and shares in their mistreatment rather than enjoy the temporary luxury and prestige that could have been his if he had sinfully ignored the plight of the Jews and if he'd identified with Pharaoh's house. He could have done that. He could have just kept going, no, hey, I'm good. Yeah, I see that. I see that these people are being abused and mistreated, and I can close my eyes to it, and I cannot make a statement about it or stand or do any of that kind of thing and just be part of the problem. But he didn't do that. That's not how he, in choosing. So it says, see, in doing that, he considered the reproach of the Christ. The reproach of the Christ, the hardship and the contempt that he, like Jesus, chose to suffer through identification with the people of God. He considered that of greater value than the treasures of Egypt. He considered it that way because he chose that over the wealth of Egypt. So that's what it says. He considered that of greater value because that's what he chose over the wealth of Egypt. See, he had that perspective because it says his eyes were focused on the eternal reward that comes only to the faithful of God. So this is what Moses is doing. And then in Midian, Moses marries Zipporah. He marries Zipporah, who's the daughter of Jethro, the priest of Midian. Now, Jethro is sometimes referred to as Reuel, or as we sometimes say, Reuel. But Reuel, he's sometimes referred to that way because probably that's his clan name. See, something like our last name. So you have, but Jethro, he marries Zipporah, Jethro's daughter, and Moses has two sons in Midian, Gershom and Eleazar. And you can see that in a couple of places. And then Moses was in Midian for a long time. So I talk about God, the way God works and the way God moves. Moses was in Midian for 40 years. I mean, 40 years? Yeah, he was in there 40 years. And so, see, God's work, not only is it beyond our comprehension what he's doing, he's working on a scale and a time frame that you and I just blows our minds. But he's there in Midian for 40 years, and during that time, the king of Egypt, the one who had been pursuing him, that Pharaoh, died. And the Israelites, though, throughout that time, continued to be sorely oppressed. And then at that time, God chooses to act in response to their cries. God, in his understanding, in his knowledge, in his plan, in his purposes, then he chooses. He's going to act, and he's going to send Moses. In Exodus chapter 3, God calls Moses to his service with this great theophany, this divine appearance of the burning bush. So here you have out here, this bush is on fire, and it's not being consumed. It's just like the flame is there. You know, kind of like one of those gas things where we have a fake log. You know, the bush is burning, but the bush isn't being consumed. So God calls him to this, and he tells him that he's going to deliver Israel from the hands of their taskmasters and bring them into the promised land, which God there describes as a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey. He says, I got something really good in store. That's what that is. And as I told you, see, that becomes a symbol for something even greater. But he's bringing them into this bountiful, blessed, secure homeland. And then he says that he's going to send Moses to Pharaoh to bring his people out. He says, I've heard them. I'm going to do something. I'm going to bring them into this land. And by the way, I'm sending you to deliver them. Well, oh. So Moses, he's not too thrilled with this idea. He balks at this idea in a number of different ways. He's balking. He said, look, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the children of Israel? Come on. Well, that's true. Who is he? Who's anybody? But that's part of his humility, by the way. But he said, come on, who am I to do such a great thing? God tells him, I will be with you. And then he says, what am I to tell them if they want to know your name? What am I going to say? Who sent me? And he says to them, you tell them that Aye sent me. Now, Aye, see, this is the first person singular form of a Hebrew verb to be. And it means I am. Okay, so you tell them that I am. But when Moses or anyone else speaks that name, then we would say, third person, he is. You see, in that form, he is, that becomes the standard reference for God. That is what's known as the tetragrammaton, those four consonants, almost certainly pronounced Yahweh. You see, almost certainly pronounced Yahweh. But it becomes a name. You see, Yahweh, that's the same, by the way, Jehovah, comes from the same, that's another attempt people have made to try to, well, how do we pronounce this? And you know the story, you see, is because the Jews in reverence wouldn't pronounce the name of God. So then you forgot, well, how is it pronounced? Because there are no vowels. It's simply consonants. And so then somebody, you know, a long time later says, well, let's put in the vowels from the Adonai, and you get Jehovah. But most scholars now say overwhelming, no, that wasn't right, it's Yahweh. Okay, that it's Yahweh. But in any event, the name, look, that name was known by earlier generations. You can see that in Genesis chapter 4, chapter 9, chapter 12, chapter 26, chapter 28, chapter 37. And also it was used by Jacob in Genesis 49, verse 18, when he blessed his son. So what I think God is doing, he says, look, you tell them that I sent them. Yahweh is sending you. And that will resonate with them. They should recognize that you are then coming as an agent of the true God, the God their ancestors worshipped. Because he's saying, what am I going to tell them? Who sent me? Then he says, after God tells Moses that the elders of Israel, he says, look, they will listen to you. They will support you. And he says, then I'm going to stretch out my mighty hand and I'm going to bring the people out of Egypt. Moses said, they're not going to believe you appeared to me. I'm going to go in there, I'm going to say, yeah, Yahweh sent me. And they're going to say, I'm not buying it. So God says, all right. He tells him, he tells him, and he even demonstrates for him that he will empower him to perform certain miracles to convince the people that God did indeed appear to him. He said, I'm going to give you some staff. You throw it down, become a snake, and become a staff again. Leprosy, appear, go away, appear, you see. Nile turned to blood. Water from the Nile turned to blood. So I'm going to give you this power to work these things that it will confirm to them that, yes, in fact, I have appeared to you. And then Moses said, look, I'm slow of speech and tongue. I'm a man of uncircumcised lips. Look, I'm not really eloquent. I can't really talk. Come on, man. You got to have a talker for this job. And God said that he would be his mouth. And he would teach him what to speak. And then finally in Exodus 4:13, Moses said, he just says, oh, my Lord, please send someone else. Will you just please send somebody else? And God was angry with him. He was angry with Moses for his unwillingness to serve, but he told him, and I think this is in his grace, he told him that Aaron would speak to the people what Moses told him to say, and that God would teach both of them what to say. And he also gave him a staff with which to perform miracles. All right, so Moses now in Midian, God has called him, argued with him, cajoled him and said, it's you I'm sending. So Moses and his family, he heads back to Egypt with his wife and his two sons. This is probably around 1446. That's the date of the Exodus. Moses, as I said, is 80 years old. Now, by the way, which given the longer lifespans, it's not really comparable to our 80. I don't want to diminish the fact he's 80, but it's not really the same. If I ever make 80, you know, I'm going to be a real charmer. Well, if I make it, I'm going to look like a raisin. It's going to be something. John will be busting on me. That's if he's around. But he's 80 years old. And on the way to Egypt for this mission, they stopped at a lodging place. And Exodus chapter 4, verse 24 says that Yahweh, or there's a textual issue here. It perhaps says an angel of the Lord. That's what the Septuagint has, and some of the Targums have. But whether it's Yahweh or an angel of the Lord, it says that he met him and sought to kill him. This is rather puzzling, peculiar, and yes, it's created all kinds of interpretations and this kind of thing. You see, it's puzzling text. Now, in the context, him, people say, well, who's him? Okay, you got some people saying, well, it's going to be Gershom or it's going to be Eliezer. In the context, it seems to me that the him refers to Moses, and the statement that God sought to kill him, it doesn't mean that God intended and attempted to kill him but wasn't able to kill him. I mean, this is a God who speaks creation into existence, so he's certainly capable of killing Moses. He could just vaporize Moses. You see, what it means is rather, it most likely means that God was killing him slowly. In other words, that he made Moses deathly ill so that he would have died if the desired corrective action hadn't been taken. In other words, he sought to kill him, and he's killing him through a process that allows time for the corrective action to be taken. In other words, he's attacking him in a way that gave them time to rectify the circumstance that had caused the judgment. And with Moses presumably incapacitated, You know, at death's door, Zipporah, she either assumed or she was told, and it wasn't reported to us, that this condition that Moses was suffering was related to his failure to have circumcised one of his sons. And so, you know, we don't know why Moses had neglected that duty. There are different ideas people spin about that, but we're not told. But Zipporah circumcised the son, and then she touched the bloody foreskin, it says, to his feet. Okay, again, whose feet? Okay, I think Moses' feet. Touches the bloody foreskin to Moses' feet. Presumably she does that. It doesn't tell us why. And we don't, you know, so it's hard to get back to what's going on with this thing. But presumably she does that to associate him with the act, since he should have been doing the circumcising, but he's incapacitated. So she circumcises, touches the bloody foreskin to his feet, and then God relented and he recovered. Then we have her statement. It says, "Surely you are a bridegroom of blood to me." Well, perhaps that's simply intended to convey her gratitude that God has now given her her husband back to her because of the blood of circumcision, because she did what should have been done, that she's now received Moses back from the dead, so to speak. Now he's her husband, but now he's her husband of, you know, the bridegroom of blood, because she gained him back through her faithfulness in doing that act. Okay, so that's something that's perhaps there. So if you notice, Moses' life has been spared repeatedly by women. You can make what you want of that, but you see women serving powerfully, serving effectively. She's not, the women aren't delivering the Israelites, but do you think it's not a big deal what they're doing? You see, the Hebrew midwives, Jochebed and Miriam, Pharaoh's daughter, now Zipporah. These aren't trivial things. Great risk to some of them. Great faith, great courage, tremendous blessing. God then uses their work in the flow of what he's doing. So not trivial, not something to cast aside. Now this incident, I think it's there because it dramatically emphasizes at the beginning of Moses' mission, his mission, the importance of obedience, the importance of covenant faithfulness for the Jewish people. God protects, God blesses, God provides. That's who he is as God, but his people are called to faithfulness. They are called to obedience. They are called to honor him with the loyalty that he deserves. And I think you see this right here, that it's so serious that after 80 years of preparation, he's going to be killed if he doesn't obey. And so it's an important thing, particularly with regard to circumcision, which became a significant distinguishing mark for the Jews. Now Moses and Aaron, they go back and they meet. Oh, is that really that late? Ooh, you're in trouble. All right, they go back and they meet with the elders of the people, and they performed in the sight of all the people the signs that God empowered Moses to do. The people believe that Moses was indeed God's representative, and they worship God for having visited them in their time of affliction. He comes and says, "I've met with God, and he sent me to you, and here are the miracle." Whoa! God is visiting us in the person of Moses. And they then worship God for that. Now in Exodus chapter 5, Moses and Aaron, they go and they say to Pharaoh, the God of Israel, they say, "The God of Israel commands you to let his people go." You got to picture this. I mean, you got to picture this. Pharaoh. And here are these guys coming in here, these Hebrews. Two guys come in and they say, we got a message for you. Yahweh, the God of Israel, he's commanding you, Pharaoh. Pharaoh's looking around going, you bring an army with you? He's commanding you to let his people go into the wilderness to hold a feast in his honor. But Pharaoh absolutely defies the Lord. He absolutely defies the Lord. Pharaoh says, "Who's Yahweh that I should obey his voice and let Israel go? I don't know Yahweh. And moreover, I'll not let Israel go." So how do you like that? You see? Absolutely defies God. And Pharaoh, see, he's historically was viewed in Egyptian society as the earthly embodiment of the god Horus. This is how Pharaoh was understood and perceived. Now, that perception was somewhat tempered by the time of Moses, but he was still seen as the holder of a divine office who in some way participated in divinity by fulfilling that role. He's more like a channel for the gods. But he still has this idea, you see, this sense that he is in some way divine. And so we have this battle shaping up, you see. So even at that level of his being divine, the conflict is really between Yahweh, the God of Israel, and the God or gods represented by Pharaoh. The statement by Pharaoh that he does not know Yahweh. You see, that means that he doesn't accord him any respect. That means nothing to me. Yahweh means nothing to me. Is essentially what he's saying. His entire response, it's dismissive and it's sarcastic. And as we would say today, it's on. It's on. He comes to Pharaoh and says, let my people go. And Pharaoh goes, all right. Okay. Now you think you, Mr. Pharaoh, and all your Egyptian gods and all this stuff, you want to throw down with Yahweh? This isn't going to turn out well for you. But okay, that's how it's going to be. That's how it's going to be. And so he does. Now Aaron and Moses, they politely say, look, the God of the Hebrews, he's met with us. He's met with us and he says, look, ask Pharaoh to please. They say, look, please let us go. Let us go 3 days' journey into the wilderness that we may offer sacrifices to Yahweh, which would have been part of the feast. That's what we 3 days' journey so we can offer sacrifices to him. Pharaoh says, in essence, look, this nonsense, this wouldn't be happening if the people didn't have so much time on their hands. That's the problem. You wouldn't be coming to me with this nonsense. Your people are too idle, and that's where they're getting all these crazy ideas. So here's what we're going to do. So he tells the Egyptian taskmasters, and he tells the Israelite foremen who are under the Egyptian taskmasters, he says, listen, you tell the people they're going to go gather their own straw to make these bricks, and by the way, they're going to make the same number of bricks. That way they won't have all this time on their hands. That way you'll stop bothering me with all this nonsense about Yahweh wants my people to go. So that's the problem. They got too much time on their hands. Well, you know, when they couldn't fulfill their quota, the Israelite foremen are beaten. Because this was crazy to come, you know, have us go out and do the same number of bricks that we're doing, and we got to spend all the time gathering the straw. How can that be? So the Israelite foreman, they get beaten, they go to Pharaoh, and they say, come on, man. This is unreasonable what you're asking us. It's just unreasonable. So they, you know, but Pharaoh, what? He won't change his mind. He says, no, that's the deal. That's how it's going to be. So they were angry with Moses and Aaron for what? For exacerbating their situation. You've made things worse. You're killing me. Oh, come over. You know, I'm going to deliver you. Look at what's happened to me. Now it's worse and things are terrible. So Moses complains to God, who said to Moses, in essence, you just keep watching. You just keep watching. And I heard the bell. I have about a half page more to go, but I got to stop. Thanks.